Hi everyone. Today in this video we are going to discuss about metoclopramide. What is metoclopramide? This drug is used as an antiemetic agent as well as prokinetic agent. Because of this prokinetic nature, this drug increases the GI motility. But at the same time, this drug is not stimulating the GI secretions. So only GI motility is going to be increased by this metoclopramide. This drug chemically belongs to the class of benzamides, and this drug acts on multiple receptors. One of the targets for this metoclopramide is the dopamine receptors. So metoclopramide acts as dopamine antagonist. Normally we know dopamine antagonists are used as antipsychotics, but this metoclopramide is not clinically used as antipsychotic. Still, this drug can produce the same side effects that are produced by these antipsychotics. So being a dopamine antagonist, metoclopramide can produce extrapyramidal side effects. So today in this video, we are going to discuss about this metoclopramide, how this drug acts, on which receptor it acts as agonist and on which receptor it acts as antagonist. What are the precautions we have to take? Possible side effects, drug interactions, and clinical use of this metoclopramide we will discuss in this video. So metoclopramide is used in two conditions where it is reducing the GI motility. One of the important use of this drug is in the treatment of GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disorder. So this is a condition of gastric reflux which is associated with heartburn, chest pain, as well as irritation in the esophagus. And in order to reduce this GERD and gastric reflux, metoclopramide can be used, which increase the GI motility and reduce the gastric reflux. And it also adjusts the lower esophageal sphincter pressure such that gastric reflux cannot be observed. Similarly, another indication of metoclopramide is in the treatment of diabetic induced gastroparesis. This is again a similar condition where if you have the symptoms such as nausea and vomiting, abdominal pain, gastric irritation, and acid reflux can be observed. Again, in such conditions, metoclopramide can be used. So this drug acts as an antiemetic agent as well as prokinetic agent. What is the chemical nature of this drug? Already we have seen that metoclopramide is a benzamide derivative. So this is the structure, and here we can observe this. This is the benzamide moiety. Similarly, we can also observe another moiety within the structure of metoclopramide. If we carefully observe this, this is nothing but para-aminobenzoic acid. So metoclopramide is a para-aminobenzoic acid PABA derivative. And because of this PABA analog, metoclopramide can produce few of the hypersensitive reactions. Now let us see how this drug acts. Metoclopramide acts on the multiple receptors, but it mainly shows its action on three important receptors. One is the 5-HT3 receptor, second one is the 5-HT4 receptor, and third one is the D2 receptors. Now, on which receptor it acts as agonist and on which receptor it acts as antagonist? First of all, let us see the role of these three receptors. The 5-HT3 receptors are responsible for the gastrointestinal relaxation, so they decrease the motility. And within the CNS, at the area postima within the CTZ, they are responsible for the induction of emesis. Similarly, 5-HT4 receptors are present locally at the enteric neurons, where they are responsible for the increased contraction and GI motility. And finally, dopamine D2 receptors are present as presynaptic, again at the enteric neurons, and they are responsible for inhibition of acetylcholine release. Now, these are the three roles of 5-HT3, 5-HT4, and D2 receptors. Here, metoclopramide acts as an antagonist at the 5-HT3 receptors, thereby inhibits the GI relaxation and emesis. Similarly, it also blocks the D2 receptors, thereby reduce the inhibitory effect of the dopamine on acetylcholine release. And finally, it acts as an agonist at the 5-HT4 receptors, which increase the GI smooth muscle contraction, resulting in the increased motility. That's why metoclopramide acts as a prokinetic agent. And since it blocks the 5-HT3 receptors at the CTZ, it also acts as antiemetic agent. So this is the colon where enterochromaffin cells are going to release the 5-HT as a local mediator. And these enterochromaffin cells are going to store the 5-HT, which is going to be released by stimulation of the colon. The signal produced by 5-HT is going to be carried through sensory neurons. These are the intrinsic primary efferent neurons. And these intrinsic primary efferent neurons are equipped with 5-HT3 receptors as well as 5-HT1 receptors. Similarly, if you have the efferent neurons are going to send the signal to the CNS, they are called as vagal primary efferent neurons, otherwise extrinsic primary efferent neurons. They are going to send a signal to the CNS. These neurons are going to send a signal to the area postrema within the CTZ, which is again equipped with 5-HT3 receptors. Now, when the colon is going to be stimulated, it can release the 5-HT. This 5-HT can act on the either intrinsic or extrinsic primary efferent neurons. When these intrinsic primary efferent neurons are activated, they are going to release further mediators like acetylcholine or CGRP, calcitonin gene-related peptide. These mediators can interact with the interneurons. These interneurons can pass the signal such that they can release further mediator acetylcholine. This acetylcholine can act on the motor neurons, which are excitatory in nature. So when this acetylcholine binds to these excitatory neurons, they further release acetylcholine, which produce contraction of the GS smooth muscle. Similarly, 5-HT, which is going to be released, can interact with the intrinsic primary efferent neurons in another way. It can stimulate another wing of interneurons, which are going to release a mediators like nitric oxide or vasointestinal peptide. These are the inhibitory mediators, which are going to stimulate the inhibitory motor neuron. So when these mediators are going to act, they are going to inhibit the contraction of the GS smooth muscle. In this way, the contraction of GS smooth muscle can be controlled by both excitatory motor neurons as well as inhibitory motor neurons. Similarly, the excitation can also be promoted by another type of 5-HT receptors. 5-HT4 receptors are present at the intrinsic primary efferent neurons. And when this 5-HT act on these receptors, it can release the more number of mediators of acetylcholine, which increase the contraction of the GS smooth muscle. That's why 5-HT4 receptors are prokinetic in nature. Now, this metoclopramide can act as antagonist at the 5-HT3 receptors. It can block the 5-HT3 receptors at the CTZ, thereby can inhibit the emesis. And it also blocks the 5-HT3 receptors, thereby inhibits the descending inhibitory motor neurons. And finally, this metoclopramide can also act as agonist at the 5-HT4 receptors, such that it can increase the release of acetylcholine, which promotes the contraction, thereby produce prokinetic activity. And apart from these actions, metoclopramide can also block the D2 receptors, which are actually responsible for inhibition of acetylcholine release. When these dopamine receptors are blocked, acetylcholine is more released, resulting in increased contraction of the GS smooth muscle. So all these actions of metoclopramide is responsible for its prokinetic as well as antiemetic actions. Now let us see the precautions of metoclopramide. Already we have seen that this drug is going to block the D2 receptors, which is responsible for its prokinetic action. But at the same time, it is also responsible for extrapyramidal side effects. So by block of these D2 receptors, metoclopramide can increase the tardive dyskinesia, commonly known as TD. This is one of the irreversible condition which is commonly observed with antipsychotics, which block the D2 receptors. And in this condition, we can observe the involuntary movements associated with face, tongue, as well as trunk. And we can observe a few of the symptoms such as difficulty in swallowing, protrusion of tongue, eye blinking, lip smacking, difficulty in breathing. All these symptoms are observed in the tardive dyskinesia produced by metoclopramide. And particularly these symptoms are more observed with metoclopramide when it is used at a high dose for a prolonged period. And this risk of tardive dyskinesia is more observed in the elders as well as in the women. So this drug should be carefully given in the elder patients. Similarly, metoclopramide can also produce other extrapyramidal side effects due to the block of D2 receptors. It can produce acute dystonias, which are shortly developed, disturbance in the tone of the muscle. resulting in few of the conditions like oculogyric crisis, involuntary movements of the eye, torticollis, twisting of the neck, laryngospasm, which results in the difficulty in eating. Similarly, if you have the Parkinson-like symptoms such as bradykinesia, tremor, muscle rigidity, and mask-like face can be observed. All this because of the increased extrapyramidal side effects produced by metoclopramide. So these symptoms should be carefully monitored in the patients. Particularly whenever tardive dyskinesia is going to be developed, immediately the drug should be withdrawn and it should be replaced with an alternative drug which is not producing tardive dyskinesia. Another important precaution of metoclopramide is this drug produces one of the syndrome neuroleptic malignant syndrome. This is one of the conditions where the body temperature is excessively raised along with some muscle rigidity and hyperpyrexia, excessive body temperature, some confusion, altered mental status, along with few of the autonomic symptoms can be observed such as tachycardia, diaphoresis, increased sweating, and irregular blood pressure as well as pulse, some rhabdomyolysis, dissolution of the muscle fiber, and acute renal failure can be observed. And this hyperpyrexia and muscle rigidity can produce some heat stroke in the patients. Another important precaution of metoclopramide is again related with the block of D2 receptors. So this drug can increase the prolactin levels resulting in hyperprolactinemia. Because of increased prolactin, it can produce few of the conditions like gynecomastia, enlargement of the breast, galactorrhea, secretion of the milk, amenorrhea, lack of menstruation. All these effects are because of action on HPA axis. HPA axis involves the hypothalamus, pituitary, as well as adrenal axis. From the hypothalamus, gonadotropin releasing hormone is going to be released, which acts on the pituitary. From the pituitary, the gonadotropes are released, which are the follicle stimulating hormone as well as luteinizing hormone. These are going to increase the steroidogenesis like testosterone and estrone. But here, metoclopramide produces hyperprolactinemia, which inhibits the gonadotropin releasing hormone by negative feedback mechanism. So this results in the decreased gonadotropes, resulting in the impotence in the patients. Similarly, metoclopramide can also increase the blood pressure. This is because of increased release of the catecholamines. And this raise in the blood pressure is further increased with the MAO inhibitors. So whenever these MAO inhibitors are combined with the metoclopramide, they can produce some severe hypertension. Similarly, this drug can also increase the aldosterone secretion, resulting in the fluid retention. Particularly, this is more troublesome in the patients who are having congestive heart failure. And finally, metoclopramide can also increase the depressive symptoms, which should be carefully monitored. What are the side effects? The general side effects of metoclopramide are mainly drowsiness, restlessness, fatigue, some nervousness and headache can be observed, and it can also produce insomnia, lack of sleep, urinary frequency, jaundice, gynecomastia, enlargement of the breast, and agranulocytosis can also be observed with this metoclopramide. What are the drug interactions? Metoclopramide is going to inhibit the actions of dopamine agonists. Dopamine agonists include bromocriptine, apomorphine, rotigotine, ropinirol. All these drugs are used to treat the Parkinson's disease. When these drugs are given with metoclopramide, the action of dopamine agonist is going to be reduced, resulting in the increased Parkinsonian symptoms. Similarly, levodopa can also interact with the metoclopramide in a similar way, and this combination increases the Parkinson's symptoms. Metoclopramide is going to be metabolized by cytochrome P450 system, and among them, CYP2D6 is one of the important enzymes. This enzyme is going to be blocked by a few of the drugs like quinidine, which is an antiarrhythmic agent, fluoxetine, paroxetine, which are antidepressants. Similarly, bupropion, which is again antidepressant. All these drugs can block the CYP2D6 enzyme. Thereby, they can increase the levels of metoclopramide and increase the extrapyramidal side effects. So, whenever these drugs are combined, the dose of the metoclopramide should be reduced in order to prevent extrapyramidal side effects. Similarly, metoclopramide can act on the CNS. So when it is given with few of the drugs which are acting on the CNS, such as anxiolytics, sedatives, opioids, and even alcohol, all these are acting like CNS depressants. So when they are combined with a metoclopramide, they can produce severe CNS depression. Another important drug interaction of metoclopramide is related with its GI motility. Since this drug is going to increase the GI motility, it can reduce the absorption of the other drugs which are depending on the GI motility. For example, the absorption of digoxin as well as atovaquone are reduced by metoclopramide. At the same time, metoclopramide can increase the absorption of few of the drugs whose absorption is increased with the GI motility. Few other drugs such as cyclosporine, tacrolimus, which are the immunosuppressants, their absorption is increased by metoclopramide. How it is given? Metoclopramide is available as a tablet as well as a solution, which is also available as an IV injection. And normally as a tablet form, it is available at dose of 5 mg and 10 mg. For the treatment of GERD, this drug can be used continuously, otherwise intermittently to treat the symptoms of the GERD. For the continuous usage, the dose of metoclopramide is initiated at 10 to 15 mg QD, quarter in die. It is given 4 times daily at a dose of 10 to 15 mg. So the maximum dose of this drug per day is 60 mg. But in the elders, the dose should be reduced. It is given at 5 mg thrice daily. Similarly, for diabetic gastroparesis, the dose of this drug is again variable from 10 mg given 4 times daily. And in the elders, the dose is reduced to 5 mg given 4 times daily. So that's about this metoclopramide. Metoclopramide is a prokinetic agent as well as an antiemetic agent. This drug blocks the 5-HT3 receptors as well as dopamine D2 receptors, but it stimulates the 5-HT4 receptors by which it increases the prokinetic activity. And it also blocks the 5-HT3 receptors at the CTZ, thereby inhibits the emesis. That's why it is used as antiemetic agent. This drug is useful in the treatment of GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disorder, as well as in the treatment of diabetic gastroparesis. This drug is available at 5 mg and 10 mg doses. Tardive dyskinesia, neuroleptic malignant syndrome, acute dystonias, hyperprolactinemia are the important precautions that should be considered when this drug is given. All these side effects are because of block of dopamine D2 receptors. This drug can also increase the hypertension when it is given with the MAO inhibitors, and it can also increase the fluid retention by increasing the aldosterone secretion. This drug is available at 2 doses like 5 mg and 10 mg, and the dose of this drug depends on the type of clinical indication. At the GERD, this drug is given at a maximum dose of 20 mg per day, and for diabetic gastroparesis, this drug is given at a maximum dose of 40 mg per day. So that's for today. Hope you have enjoyed this video. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel. Share this video with your friends. Post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching this video.